All right. So, hello, welcome to my audience of two. And so this is the part two of the discussion on UN intertwiners and the Grassmannian, and how this Grassmannian structure appears in loop quantum gravity, right? So that in yesterday's talk, I covered the basic notions of quantum geometry and how they are used to describe polyhedra, and we talked about what are some of the constraint equations that a polyhedra needs to satisfy, and then I started talking about the semi-classical state. And I briefly talked about coherent states. And so today we have to, the goal is to start talking about the coherent states. First, we'll talk about how to describe, we'll talk about the state space of polyhedra in a slightly different parametrization that is also known as the Schwinger boson picture. So let me do that. Okay, so the Schwinger boson picture of spin networks. Okay. So, what are the basic operators, the basic kinematic operators? In LQG are the angular momentum variables associated with any edge, right? So with any edge, you have some representation, right? And you will have the angular momentum operator. It's not updating. Okay. You'll have the angular momentum operator, right? Where I is the edge index. I is equal to 1 to NE, where N of E is equal to the number of edges, right? So from this, we get the area operator and all that. So what we are going to do is, what is the state space of a, okay, second, having some network issues on my tablet. So what sort of physical system does this set of operators describe, right? I mean, if you were to talk about the classical, so we talk about edges as being associated with quantum states and all, but if you took a classical limit, right, what would be the physical system living on a single edge, right? And so in the classical limit, what you have is a rotor, right? Something which has a angular momentum, right? And on a single this thing, in the quantum limit, right? What are you talking about? Right? You're talking about a harmonic oscillator, basically, right? Because this will give you the harmonic oscillator algebra. Right, Jx, Jy will give you J plus minus, and then you'll have JZ, right? So you get the angular momentum algebra. So you get a quantum rotor, right? And so here you have the classical angular momentum. Here you have the angular momentum operator. And how would we, what are the states that we normally associate with the, so we, let's look at the physics of a harmonic oscillator once again, right? So what is the Hamiltonian for a harmonic oscillator? Into, let me see what up. J plus dagger J plus plus one now. Okay, so this is J plus and this is the dagger, right? So normally you would see it written as A dagger A, but we'll be using the letters A and B for something else in a minute. And also in this case, well, everything is labeled with J. So now, so what is the ground state of this Hamiltonian, right? So we know that there is a vacuum, there is a ground state, and if you act on this vacuum, right, you get this. Because this quantity, which is called the number operator, is zero, right? And then it has a set of eigenstates, right? What are the eigenstates? Eigenstates are n, where n belongs from one to infinity, right? The set of non-negative integers, and the action of these states, right? So you have J plus acting on N, and this gives you root of N plus one. Plus one. J minus gives you root n minus one, right? So these are called the raising and lowering operators. Okay. So this is what a harmonic oscillator Hamiltonian looks like. And where do this J plus and J minus come from? So J plus minus are defined to be, you have the position and momentum operators, right? So you have X plus minus IP, right? So you have a position operator and a momentum operator. You perform a canonical transformation on your phase space, right? You're taking X and P and transforming to a new set of variables, which is J plus and J minus, classically, right? And so then using the fact, for instance, that the momentum operator can be written like this in the position representation, and X hat, well, that is just X. From this, you can find out that the vacuum state is annihilated by the J minus. And this allows you to solve for the vacuum state, right? Because then this becomes a simple differential equation. And you find that the vacuum state goes as something like exponent of minus something X squared by 2 alpha, right? That's a Gaussian. Now I've made a slight pedagogical error, which is that I'm talking about the harmonic oscillator when I should be talking about a particle with angular momentum. But they are somewhat similar, right? in that the similarity lies in the fact that, well, a harmonic oscillator, that they both have ladder operators, right? They both have this step-like structure. And they both have this concept of the number operator and so on. So what I've talked about here is harmonic oscillators. And yeah, I guess, apologies, you should not confuse this with the angular momentum algebra. The angular momentum algebra is different, right? So this is the angular momentum algebra. Okay. And what is this? We have Jx, Jy, and Jz, right? And we can also write down J square, which is the sum of the squares of the three. And so if you want to find a complete set of commuting operators, right? Conventionally, one chooses J square and Jz. Right? So states are labeled by eigenvalues of J square and Jz, right? So if you have some state which is an eigenstate of this, right, it will have some eigenvalue like this. Right? Where psi is, so psi are the eigenstates that we're interested in. So we label psi in this way, right? J comma M, where J is the total angular momentum and M is the magnetic quantum number, right? And what is the full spectrum of the of states? So what are the allowed values of M? So J is a constant, right? This J is a constant. Right? This is determined by the representation labeling the edge, right? So if the representation, if the edge is a spin one half or spin one or spin two or spin three halves, then that's what J is going to be, right? It's fixed. What about M? Well, you can show that M takes values in the set of numbers going from J minus one, right? Minus J plus one, then minus J plus two, I guess, till J minus one, right, minus J plus one, right? So each time you get an increment of one in the magnetic quantum number to J minus one comma J, right? So the spectrum of, so how many values of M are there? The number of eigenvalues of M is 2J plus one. Right, and conventionally you denote this spectrum in this way, right? You say that, well, this is your z-axis, right? And what you do is you measure the projection of your angular momentum in the z, along the z-axis, right? So, and this projection is what changes by an integer quantity every time you go from one. So this is an integer. Well, it's actually equal to one. This is one, right? So it's like the hands of a clock, which starts at six, right? And then it ticks up by a discrete amount each time until it reaches the 12 o'clock position, right? And so here you have Jz is equal to minus J, and here you have JZ is equal to plus J. And the way you derive this algebra is that, well, first of all, you have the set of commutation relations, right, between your operators. And then you perform a canonical transformation, which is identical to the one that is used in the harmonic oscillator case. Right? The difference is that instead of x and p, you have jx and jy. Right? So you can think of this as your position operator, and you can think of this as your quote unquote momentum. Okay? The difference is that, what is the main key difference? These operators, right, in this harmonic oscillator case, they are unbounded. Their eigenvalues don't have any limits, right? They're minus infinity to infinity. But these operators are bounded, right? So you have a discrete phase space and a compact phase space. And so using this angular momentum algebra, one can show that if you take J plus and act on this, you will get modulo some constant of proportionality. You will get J M plus one, right? If M is less than J, and J minus, again, modulo some constant of proportionality, you get J M minus one, if M is greater than minus J. And if M is equal to J, then J plus J comma M will give you zero. And if M is equal to minus J, J minus J comma M will give you zero, right? So your spectrum is bounded from below and from above. And you can also define a number operator in exactly the same way, which looks like this. So the number operator, I'm not sure. One second, let me just see what notation is used here. I guess the same notation is used. So I'll put the plus here again and the dagger here. And I'll try to make the dagger a little bit more conspicuous, okay? So I'll call this J plus J minus. This is the number operator. All right? So now the first step in constructing the state space of these polyhedra. So let me give you a bunch of references first. One of the earliest papers, which talked about this, was by Girelli and Levine. And they actually pointed out the quantum of informational characteristics of spin networks. Okay. And then, okay. And then there was another paper, which is by I think Levine and Speziale.
Sir, I'll just be back in a moment. Somebody's knocking on my door.
Okay, I'll pause the recording. All right, so these are the two references. One is Girelli and Levine, 2005. Then Levine and Turnow, 2006. Girelli and Levine is titled Reconstructing Quantum Geometry from Quantum Information, Spin Networks as Harmonic Oscillators. And the second paper is part two of the same project, which talks about things like entanglement and renormalization and so on. And in many ways, these papers are very very groundbreaking. They are revolutionary, because see, this is in 2005 and 2006, right? And the whole tensor network line of research, which is now dominating what used to be known as string theory, is began in around the same time, but a few years later, in fact. So it was motivated by the discovery by Ryu and Takanagi of the Ryu-Takanagi conjecture, relating the entropy of extremal surfaces in ADS-CFT to the entanglement between different regions of the boundary CFT. But it was all really kicked into high gear by the work by Mark Van Ramstonk in 2009, I think, and then work by Brian Swingle in 2009, 10, 11. And so you have, so what was realized from those works was the importance of entanglement in understanding the structure of space-time geometry. But what you have is that you have these people in 2006 who are writing these papers, right? And they already recognize the importance of entanglement in quantum geometry. But because of the sheer sociological weight of the string theory community, the contribution from LQG is as if it never happened. Hopefully, history will correct these errors. We'll see. Unfortunately, I don't think that history has any default sense of justice the way that we would like it to have. Okay, so now we want to talk about this Schwinger boson representation of an oscillator. And what is this representation? We are going to introduce a different set of operators. We're going to introduce so the operators, we're going to introduce AA dagger and BB dagger, okay? And they satisfy the commutation relations, AA dagger and BB dagger is equal to 1, right? And A and B are both 0, okay? So what is this? This is just the harmonic oscillator, SHO. So we have just introduced two copies of the harmonic oscillator. And this just tells us that the harmonic oscillators, right, they're not coupled. I mean, you can couple them through a Hamiltonian or whatever, but the state spaces are not inherently, don't affect each other. What happens in one state remains in, one space remains in that space. So in terms of these two operators, we define our angular momentum operator now, JZ, right? So this is the same angular momentum operator that we had earlier, and we write it like that. Okay, and so this can be written as NA minus NB, right? Because this is the number operator of A, and this is the number of operator of the B type quanta, right? So you can imagine, so if you want to construct the Hilbert space, right, of which is generated by these operators, what would it be? You would have two types of harmonic oscillator quanta. You would have A type and B type, right? So instead of just saying that you have N, this is for a single SHO, right? You have two SHOs, right? So eigenstates would be labeled by two number operators, right? NA and NB, right? So this is the Hilbert space of a single SHO, and this is the Hilbert space of two harmonic oscillators, okay? And what would be the action of these operators? Well, it would be what one might expect. This would give you NA, right? And this would give you NB. And similarly, if you act on this state with A dagger, or with A, you would either increment or decrement NA. And likewise, if you act on this state with B and B dagger, you would increment or decrement NB, Okay. So in terms of these two oscillators, right, we have defined, so let me write it down again, clarity, A dagger A, B dagger B, okay? And then we are going to write down J plus as A dagger B. So again, let me try to make my daggers more daggery. And then J minus is what, the Hermitian conjugate of J plus, right? So this is going to be B conjugate A. Right. Yeah, I think there is a typo in the Girelli and Levin paper. And then we would define an operator E, which is just the total number operator. And this is B beta. Now you can check, and this is an exercise, right? Exercise, show that these operators satisfy the SU2 algebra, right? So, and using these commutation relations, and you can show it, it's just making a couple of lines. And so from J plus and J minus, you can reconstruct JX also, JX and JY. So JY is equal to J plus minus J minus by 2, right? Just by reversing that transformation. Okay. And so the commutation relations of the J plus and J minus. Now, what is the commutation relation here? This is equal to 2 times JZ. And the commutator of JZ with J plus minus is equal to plus or minus J plus minus. So this is the expression, by the way, which tells you that acting on a state with J plus or with J minus gives you an eigenstate of JZ with one, with the eigenvalue decremented or incremented by one unit. Okay. So you can see that by, let me just show you how that works. Let's look at this expression, J plus. Okay, and then let's act on an eigenstate of JZ. Okay, and so an eigenstate of JZ, we'll just write it as M, J plus M, right? So what do we get? We get on the right, we get JZ from the first term, J plus M, right? And then here we get J plus JZM equal to J plus M, right? And now this is going to just give me M times the eigenstate M. So the expression becomes J times J plus M minus M times J plus M, right? Because JZ acting on M just gives me the eigenvalue of JZ, which is M. And on the right, I get J plus M. And so now I can take this guy to the right. And if I take it to the right, what do I get? I find that JZ acting on J plus M gives me M plus 1 times J plus M, right? So what this tells me is that J plus M acting on M is also an eigenstate of JZ. It's an eigenstate of JZ with an eigenvalue, which is one unit greater, right? And similarly for J minus, right? So these are the commutation relations. Now, so we have these two sets of states, two different characterizations of the same set of states. The first characterization is in terms of J comma Z, right? And the other is in terms of NA and NB. And the point is that they're equivalent, okay? Now we can write down the these quantities. What is J? This J. This J is the eigenvalue of J square, right? So I get J square acting on, on M is equal to J comma M, right? And so again, you can show that, you know, just from the relations between the two sets of states, that this J is equal to 1/2 NA plus NB. Okay. So again, I'll leave that as an exercise. And what is M? M is equal to, M is the eigenvalue of JZ, right? And what is JZ? Well, JZ is this quantity. We define it to be the difference between the number operators divided by 1/2. So what is the relation between M and these numbers? NA minus NB. Again, excellent. Okay. And then we define this. Yeah, sure.
Could you go up a little bit to where you wrote the commutation relations? So you said that JZ, J plus and J minus were the generators of the SU2 algebra.
The three of them, J plus, J minus and JZ. Or you can use JX, JY and JZ.
So if you take any two of those generators and take commutation relation, shouldn't you get the third generator?
That's if you are working in the JX, JY, JZ basis.
Oh, okay.
If you work with the J plus minus basis, this is the commutation relation.
Oh, okay.
Right? Okay. You have changed the basis, right, in which you're working by performing this coordinate, this canonical transformation. Right? We have changed so the commutation relation will also change, right? But they're equivalent to each other.
Right? That I can see.
Right. Now, and what is the action of this operator E on J comma M? And so E was defined to be A dagger A. So just from the definition, we get this. J comma M. And then, well, this we already know. Okay. All right. So this is fine. Now, one question that you might ask is, well, the spectrum of the angular momentum operator is bounded, right, below and above. But the spectrum of the harmonic oscillator is unbounded from above. So how would the two map into each other, right? And so the way they map into each other is through the fact that, first of all, remember that this quantity J is kept fixed. When you talk about a single oscillator, single angular moment, single rotor, right, or a single edge labeled by a representation, the value of that representation is fixed to some J, right? Like 1/2 or 1 or whatever. So fixing that value of J, what it does is it fixes the sum of NA plus NB. Right? So effectively in the individual simple harmonic oscillator state spaces, you will not be going through the whole spectrum, right? Either NA can go up, but how high can NA go? NA can only go up to 2J, while NB is zero. And similarly, NB can go up to 2J if NA is kept to zero, right? So if you look at the SHO spectrum, right? You start at the ground state. NB is equal to zero. And then you increase in one unit every time, right? And this goes up to infinity, and this goes up to infinity. But the fact that the JZ, the total angular momentum is given by 1/2 of NA plus NB, right? So the limiting value of NA, if you keep NB to be zero, the limiting value of NA is going to be 2J. And similarly, the limiting value of NB is going to be 2J. So all of these states above, they don't come into play at all, right? So we are still dealing with a finite state space. Okay, is it? I hope I'm not saying anything which is. And if you don't understand everything on the first go, that's okay. That's perfectly fine. It took me more than one go to understand what's going on, and even then I cannot say that I understand everything as well as that. Yeah.
But why is the angular momentum fixed?
Well, because the angular momentum, you have a label, right? You have a J label, right? What does this J label tell you? This J label tells you which rep of SU2 is associated with the given edge, right?
Mm.
And so what is the Hilbert space? The Hilbert space is at J. The Hilbert space of a single edge. Right? So in a given spin network state, you have to make a choice of the labelings of all the edges, right?
But then don't we sum over all the representations, all the real values of J?
We would later, yeah. We would do that later when calculating things like partition functions and all.
So when you do that, then again you're...
No, so then you have to... Then right. I mean, then you do get some divergences and so on. But there are a number of ways of keeping control of those divergences. One way is that you just put a cutoff on the highest value of J. Okay, so just arguing that you can't have very high spins, you know, at the Planck scale for whatever reason. And the other method is that instead of working with SU2, you work with a deformation of SU2 into what is called a quantum group. Though it's not technically a group, it's an algebra called the Hopf algebra, and it's labeled by SU2K. The K is some non-integer parameter. Well, it can be integer also. So whereas SU2, the representations are unbounded, right? It's all the set of all positive half integers. SU2K, the number of representations is finite. There's an upper limit which is set by K. And this has a direct physical motivation, which comes from the fact that when you work in some background, you have a cosmological constant, then it turns out that to make your theory consistent, you have to work with SU2K labels instead of SU2. Okay, so you know that's the sort of quote unquote physical justification for where that SU2K can come. But at this point, we're not worried about all that. This point, we don't care because we're talking about an intertwiner, and the intertwiner corresponds to a fixed labeling of all the edges, right? So we're not summing over all the labels there as yet. Okay, is that fine? So now we can define the Casimir operator, right? Which is basically the square of the area. Or no, that is the area, right? So vector J squared. And so if you just use the commutation relations, you can, so this is equal to JX squared, JY squared, JZ squared. And if you use the commutation, this thing, the J plus and J minus operators, then this term can be written as this term, right? And what are the eigenvalues of these operators? So what is the eigenvalue of this operator acting on this thing? State is equal to E times E plus one. Okay, and what is E? E, remember, E is the total number operator, right? So E is just equal to J, right? The maximum value of J, right? Okay. The value which is kept fixed. So this is just like writing J times J plus one. Right, so we have these guys. Now we can talk about the algebra associated with the algebra associated with a polyhedra. Okay, all right. So let's do that. So before we do that, what we would also like to understand is how to go back and forth between the two sets of states, right? And well, how to go back and forth? Well, you just have this equivalence, right? N A is equal to N B, right? And so let me use the notation is used. So instead of an angular ket or a bra, we're using this curved bra to denote the fact that this is a state which lives in the harmonic oscillator state space. Okay, and now, if you remember, this state can be constructed from the vacuum, right? How do you construct it from the vacuum? You take the creation operator and you act NA times on the vacuum state, right? But then what happens is each time you act on the vacuum state, you get each time you act on one of those angular momentum states, you increment or decrement. Okay. Each time you increment or decrement, you get a factor of root n plus one, right? So this just comes out from the requirement that these eigenstates are normalized. So when you count all the factors, you get this thing, n a factorial here. And similarly, NB can be written as B dagger NB acting on. So this is zero in the A, this is zero in the B state, root NB factor. And so J comma M is equal to NA NB, which is equal to A dagger NA B dagger NB acting on 0, 0. And now this 0, 0 is in the harmonic oscillator basis. NA factorial NB. Okay. So this is our now the reason for doing this is because we want to construct coherent states. Well, we know how to construct the coherent states for a harmonic oscillator. As I explained in the end of yesterday's lecture, the coherent states for a single harmonic oscillator are simply the eigenstates of the annihilation operator. Okay? So we can construct the coherent states of these two sets of operators, the A oscillators and the B oscillators. Right? So there will turn out to be a relationship between those two sets of those two coherent states and then the coherent states of SU. Okay, so but we are not going to talk about the coherent states of SU2 right now. We're going to continue talking about the algebra of the this intertwiner state space. Okay. So with this terminology in hand, we can talk about the intertwiner algebra or the polyhedra algebra. Okay. So again, for simplicity, I will just draw things in two dimensions, but it's understood that each of these lines is actually a face, a two-dimensional face. All right. So with each puncture on the face of a polyhedron, right, you have an angular momentum that is associated, right, corresponding to the fact that the edge is labeled by some representation, right? So small j corresponds to the value of the representation. Big J is the set of operators, the angular momentum operators, which will act on that given edge, right? So what we can do now is perform the same canonical transformation, okay, but now on each edge separately, right? What we did for one edge, we can do for all the edges separately. So now instead of J1, we would have NA comma NB, right? Or NA1 and NB1, right? And you would have the set of operators, A dagger 1, A1, B dagger 1. B dagger 1 and B1 again, right? So similarly with the ith edge, you would have the set of operators, AI dagger, AI, BI dagger, BI, NAI, NBI, right? And as I've just shown you, this would give you exactly the corresponding angular momentum state space for the degrees of freedom living on that edge, right? Okay. Now, you remember that in yesterday's talk, I talked about one of the things we talked about was these dihedral angles, right? So what is the dihedral angle? The dihedral angle is that you have two edges, right? And the dihedral angle is the angle between the faces. So let me try to use different colors. So these are the edges. These are the faces. The faces intersect somewhere, right? And there's an angle here, alpha, which is the dihedral angle. Okay. And what was the relation? How did you get this dihedral angle? Well, we saw that if you had the face normals, right, ni and nj, if you took the dot product, you would get ni magnitude, nj magnitude, cosine theta ij, right? So now if you want to define the geometry of, let's say, a tetrahedron, which is the simplest three-dimensional solid, right? That requires us to be able to understand the action of this operator, right? One of the dihedral operators. So we need to define that operator, right? So what does that look like in terms of these A and B? So this is the classical version. And in the quantum case, instead of ni dot nj, what would we do? We'll take ji dot jj, right? This would be the operator corresponding to the normals to the faces. Okay. Now, need to refer a little bit. As I told you in the beginning, please don't mind if I stumble a few times. Right. Yeah. So these are the operators, right? And the area is given by this ni magnitude square is equal to 2ai, right? Where again, this 2 factor of 2 is the convention used in the papers by Levine and Speciale. Okay. And these are both the classical, for the classical case. And for the quantum case, you have the operator ji. Right? So ji, you get ji square. And the eigenvalue of ji square is equal to the area, right? And ji dot jj, this is the quantum equivalent of ni dot nj, right? So if you want to define an operator for the dihedral angle, how would you do that? You would write down something like this, times, let's see, one second. So ji dot jj, right. So let's say you act on some state psi. And so this would give you something like the ji, where, let's see. Something like ji times jj times cosine theta ij. right? So you would define this operator theta ij, something like this. You would define it as ji dot jj over ji times jj psi, okay, is equal to cosine theta ij. When it comes to operators, you always have to be careful when you are inverting such identities, but it can be done. Okay. All right. So now let's use the harmonic oscillator algebra that we developed earlier and see what happens with this ji dot dot jj term. Okay. So what will this give me? I can write this as jix, jjx, jiy, jjy, jjz. Okay. So what am I doing? I'm taking the operators associated with this edge and with this edge, right? And they're nearest neighbors. Remember, these edges are nearest neighbors. And then using the this thing in terms of the harmonic oscillator variables, we define this set of operators, which will play a role similar to this jij, which is called eij. And remember, what was the definition of the E operator? The E operator was defined as 1/2 A dagger A plus B dagger B. So now that I have more than one phase, I should write it as, right, I should put an index I, because there'll be a different E operator for each phase. And so we can generalize this to Eij. So Eij, and then, well, the factor of A of 1/2 goes away, becomes AIAJ, BI dagger, BJ. Okay? And this is a Hermitian operator. Not a Hermitian operator. Eij dagger is equal to Eji, right? You can just see that by switching the indices. Right. So what is the effect of this Eij? This is like a hopping term, right? If you remember from many body physics, right? You have a Hamiltonian, which looks like something like some constant, let me call it T summation of I, summation over nearest neighbors, Ci dagger Cj, right? This is the Hamiltonian for some air particles which are coupled to each other with a nearest neighbor coupling, right? And what does the Ci-Cj term describe? That if you have a set of sites, okay, so you have a site I and you have a site I plus one, let's say. So when you act on this with Ci dagger Ci plus one, what does it do? The Ci plus one will act on this site, right? And assuming that there is an electron on this side, what will happen? It will be annihilated, right? This is an annihilation operator. And we are not worried about this. So this is a very simplistic picture, right? And this doesn't have to be an electron. This can just be a particle, spinless, chargeless particle. So this particle is annihilated by the action of Ci plus one. And there is a particle which is created at the ith site due to the action of CI dagger. Okay, so typically these CI, CJ, these are they satisfy this fermionic anti-commutation, right? CI, CJ. So from this anti-commutation, this fermionic anti-commutation, you can see that if you take CI dagger acting on the vacuum, you will get 1, and then CI dagger acting on 1 will give you 0, right? So you only have 2 states. Fermions can only have one fermion in a state, right? Is it fine? Is it? You want to take a moment to digest this? Should I pause the recording?
No, sir. No. It's fine.
So what is this guy doing? Right. This is saying that I'm annihilating 1 degree of freedom, right? 1 excitation from the jth phase. And I'm creating 1 excitation of the A type on the I phase, right? So this is the I phase and this is the J phase, and they are both they are adjacent. If they are not adjacent, that operator is not defined. Well, I mean, you can define that operator. You can define that operator for any pair of phases. So that's not strictly not correct. Okay. And so here you have some particles of type A and some particles of type B, right? And so when you act on this with AI, AJ, BIBJ, what does it do? Right. So this is, let's say, NA, and this is NB. What will happen? Well, it will annihilate 1 particle from here of the type A and put it on the I phase, and it will annihilate 1 particle of the type B and put it on the, right? So this is a hopping term. This is like a kinetic term, okay? And what is being transferred is the quanta of area. So if you decrease NA and NB, what happens? You decrease the area of one phase and you increase the area of another phase. Okay, that's what the action of these operators. Now, what is the relevance of what is the property? These operators have a very nice property, which is what? Let's talk about the SU2 symmetry of the polyhedral state space. Okay. Right. So what is the generator of SU2? The generator of SU2 is what? It is just this angular momentum operator, right? That's what we mean by a symmetry, right? And so if you ask what is the generator of, how does SU2 act on the whole polyhedra, right? What is the corresponding generator for the whole polyhedra? So I'll put an I over here. For the whole polyhedra, what will the total generator of SU2 be? It will be the sum of the generators on each of the phases. Okay. Now, in this entire discussion, it helps to think of the state space in this way. Remember that when we are talking about NA con NB, what do we actually mean? We mean NA tensor NB, right? And what do we mean when I say that, let's say you have A dagger B, some operator like this acting on NA NB. What does it actually mean? Is this really just A dagger B? No, right? What is this operator? The proper way to write it out is A dagger tensor I identity acting on B, right? Because you have a composite Hilbert space, right? So the operators for the single Hilbert space cannot act on the composite Hilbert space, right? You have to have operators which live in the tensor product space. So A dagger and B, they don't live in the tensor product space. A dagger tensor IB lives on the tensor product space. And this has the effect of changing only the A-type oscillators. And then you can multiply this by identity A tensor B. This is the quote-unquote correct way to write down these operators, right? So similarly, when you're working with the state space of a polyhedra, right? So what is the state space of the polyhedra? It is the tensor product of the state space of each face, right? And the face Hilbert space is the same as the edge Hilbert space, right? So you're taking the tensor product of however many edges there are. So if I want to write down this operator J of I, what is the quote unquote correct way to write it? The correct way is this, right? Identity one, identity two, identity I minus one, JI, I plus one, dot, dot, dot. What happened here? Okay. Go away. Okay. Dot, dot, dot. Tensor I n. That is what this means actually. Okay. When I say that J of I is acting, because the whole polyhedral state space is not the, it's single HI, it's the tensor product of all those HI. So you should think of this J, when I say J, when you think of this J1 plus J2, what is J1 plus J2, right? J1 plus J2, the correct way to write it is that J1 I2 J, like, right? And similarly, if you have J1, J2, J3, and Jn, you do the same thing. But you can imagine how complicated the expressions would look if people actually use this notation, right? So if instead of writing J of I wrote this, then this kind of an expression would look like this, right? J is equal to, I'd have to write identity one, dot, dot. Well, I'd have to say, sorry, J1 tensor I2 dot, dot, IN plus identity one, tensor J2 dot, dot, tensor IN, right? Dot, 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 I1, tensor I2, dot, 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 tensor Jn minus one, tensor In, right? So you can see that the complexity of the notation increases and expressions become difficult to follow. Right? So this is not normally emphasized often enough in most discussions of quantum mechanics, though it should be. So the total generator of SU2 transformations on the polyhedral state space is this guy. So it's the total angular momentum operator on the intertwiner. And now this has a very nice property, which is what? Well, that not this J, but these E operators have a very nice property that for all IJ, if you look at summation of k is equal to 1 to n, JK, where I hope you understand what I mean by this notation, comma EIJ is equal to 0. So the action of EIJ commutes with the action of SU2, right? And so these operators, so that's why these operators are nice. Okay. That tells me that EIJ will give me something that is conserved, right? EIJ will correspond to some conserved quantity. Now I can calculate the commutation algebra of this of pairs of this EIJs and EKLs, right? So EIJ for one pair of faces and EKL for another pair of faces. I can calculate it. I insert this expression for EIJ and the same expression with just the indices K and L. And then you get a bit of a long calculation and the end result looks something like this. JKIL delta IL EKJ. Okay, so again, this is an exercise. It's a tedious exercise, but it's a very important exercise, okay? All of these steps you have to show for yourselves that, well, this is actually what is happening. Okay? And now, this algebra, okay? So this particular set of relations, this defines a certain kind of Lie algebra, right? And so you can ask, well, what kind of a group, what is the Lie algebra, or what is the group whose Lie algebra has this structure, right? And so this is the Lie algebra of U of n, which we will write as small u of n, right? Because remember, SO2 is the group, SO2 is the algebra, right? This is the conventional notation. So my small u doesn't look very much different from a V, but we'll just have to work with that. Okay, so what is U of n? U of n is the group of n by n unitary matrices, right? And so if you have n by n unitary matrices, okay? And the fact that all of these EIJs, they commute with the SU2 generator, right? This tells us that our polyhedral state space has this UN symmetry. That's where this term UN intertwiners comes from. Okay. And I think I'll stop here because, you know, it's already like almost an hour and a half. Can't even realize how much I had written down. Okay. So we started with this Schwinger boson picture of a single, first I just talked about harmonic oscillator, then I talked about the angular momentum or algebra. Again, if you have forgotten some of this, you need to go back, crack open your quantum mechanics textbook to whatever chapter it is that you have forgotten, whether it's chapter one or the preface or the table of contents, and you have to sit down and work through all the details. There are no shortcuts. And if you don't know your angular momentum algebra and your harmonic oscillator algebra, then you will get lost at some point, somewhere along the way. And things will just simply stop. And the reason I know that is because I've been. Okay, so take it from me. All right, so then I talked about this angular momentum state space. Then we introduced this set of harmonic oscillator operators. In terms of these harmonic oscillator operators, I told you that we can define, we can write down these guys, JZs, in terms of these harmonic oscillator operators. And this is the relationship. And then using the harmonic oscillator commutation relations, you can check explicitly that the operators which are defined in this way, JZ, J plus, and J minus, satisfy the, so what is this? This is the SU2. Or if I'm being pedantic about it, I'll say small SU2. Right? So having established that, and if I want to be really pedantic about it, I would say SU2 or SO3 algebra. Of course, when it comes to mathematics, there's no end to how pedantic one can be. Now, and then there are some simple things to show that the total number operator is J and that M is equal to this. This is kind of obvious. You don't have to do anything to show this, but this one is a little bit more tricky, okay? And then I talked about, well, how you map the spectrum of the SHO to the spectrum of the rotor, because one is infinite and the other is compact. So, you know, the way it works is that we are only talking about a compact sector of the harmonic oscillator state space. Then we define the Casimir. And then finally, we talk about the intertwiner algebra. We perform the Schwinger boson construction on each edge separately. And we define these operators. These operators are, you can think of them as kinetic terms. If you have some particles which live on the edges, which would correspond to quanta of area, right, of the A type and the B type. And then you have the total angular momentum operator, and then some background on tensor products and so on. And that this. And so you have to do this. This is a very important exercise. Okay. And then, and this is also an important exercise. Okay, and then this algebra is the same as the algebra of UN matrices. Okay, so I'll stop here today. And in the next part, what we will do is we will introduce another set of operators, which is the F operators. And then it will be time to also introduce the spinorial representation, the spinorial language for for LQG. That will also be needed. And then finally, once we have introduced spinners and this UN algebra, then we can define the coherent states, the UN coherent states. And then somewhere along the line, we will see eventually that the UN coherent states turn out to be labeled by elements of the graph maybe. Okay, so let me just write down what's next. Next, we'll talk about intertwiner annihilation creation operators. This will complete the UN algebra part. Then we'll talk about the SU2 spinners. And then finally, we'll come to the UN coherent states. Okay? Okay. Questions? Probably no questions. I think there is a lot to digest in here. Right? So time to get to work. All right.